Hello, Benji von Kramen here, a fellow user of RealityCapture, a program that never fails to amaze me and keeps getting better. I'm here to talk about optimizing for game engines. I'll be in Unreal, but surely this applies more broadly. It's one thing to render out a polished animation like this scene I scanned, actually separate scans, the Gothic chair, table, and stone floor, each separately captured here in my house in Atlanta, the cow skull and library from a colleague in Texas. But what about real time? I'm happy with the frame speeds as I navigate in real time on a 4K monitor. Not bad considering all my light sources are movable. Even gesture-controlled lighting is seamless. I began by limiting max texture count to 5 8K diffuse and normal maps. These used to scan fairly dense geometry at 1.5 million tries, or polys if you wish. At a steady 60 frames per second, I was curious how much more detail I might glean from source data before seeing frame rates begin to drop. I returned to Reality Capture and switched Style to Fixed Texel Size under the Unwrap tool. From the original 5 8K maps, I now had 9. Still no drop in frame rate. With 32 gigs of RAM, memory pressure was also low, so I went back and reprojected color using Fixed Texel Size on a bunch more. I was personally shocked to learn there wasn't black smoke pouring out the back of my trusty GoBox laptop after loading 77 8K diffuse and as many normal maps, and in the case of the table and chair, roughness and specular maps as well. Obviously, Unreal's texture streaming works miracles. 60 frames per second most of the time, even on big wide shots. But because this library scene was to adjoin other spaces, a cave and an industrial scene, I was concerned about loading ever more heavy geometry. So I began thinking about how I might reduce poly count without visibly sacrificing the detailed silhouettes I'm after. I'm honestly a bit late to the party taking advantage of normal maps in RC. A godsend that developers listened to us users on this one, making it possible to efficiently deal with baked maps inside of Reality Capture. My understanding is incomplete on this one, but since my scans are aimed at static, hard structures, and they're not large procedural landscapes, displacement maps aren't for me. But here's my frame on normal maps, and how this influenced my approach to managing poly count through selective decimation. If a surface lends itself to the illusion of fine texture strictly through lighting effects, a good example being the bumpy surface of this flagstone floor, I'll take it. Wins me the latitude in poly count to chop an original 11 million polys down to a few thousand. Maybe I could say the same for this bit of asphalt. But no, those deep cracks and all the fine debris strewn about. The minute the camera moves, the eye would pick up on it being smooth and flat. And that's just with motion parallax. Flying the camera close to the ground and in stereo 3D, you want to preserve the dimensionality, even at smaller scales. So, what this implies for workflow is that you don't want a one-size-fits-all approach to decimation. We're going to round trip in a free third-party app. And we're going to selectively decimate there twice, exporting twice along the way with high and low poly meshes for reprojection back in Reality Capture. From the perspective of a traditional CG artist, and I'm definitely not one, this approach to optimization is still very one-size-fits-all, relatively speaking. But it's a start for working with scan data representing complex scenes. Reconstruction in Reality Capture returned a component for a section of this library that began with 262 million tries. My thinking in selecting this particular region of the library for Reconstruction Region 01 in fact, was itself informed by the need for selective decimation. The bric-a-brac on the top shelf contains a much greater volume of complex geometry than the lined-up books below. Were these combined in a single component, too aggressive with the simplify tool, and you lose your nice silhouettes on the bric-a-brac. But then what's appropriate there would leave the simpler books with too great a density of polys, so we split. Quick side note. After reading on forums that ZBrush's Decimation Master was superior to all the rest, I ran a test. I can't tell the difference. You tell me. ZBrush and Reality Capture took about the same amount of time to process, but then time lost to the round trip, this for no appreciable gain in quality, I wouldn't bother. To use a consistent naming routine that I can understand later, I titled this first component LO1A262M. L for library, 01 for this first wall, A for the top shelf of that wall. And though the tri-count is displayed in RC, I include that info to then feed recognizable file names for export and backup down the road. I then run simplify, basing the target tri-count not on a percentage, but rather on the upper-end file size I can comfortably work with in MeshMixer, 30 million in my case. But I'll even bring that down to 15 million to work faster when I know this still preserves plenty of detail for a given patch of a scene. Before giving this new component a title, I'll clean the model, name this new component LO1A15MRC, nuke the parent component, and export to OBJ, being sure to disable preserve parts. No need to bother with exporting the info file. In MeshMixer, I can finally fly around to get a truer impression of quality and of problems. I make note of artifacts in which tools I'll use to mitigate problems, then break the scene further down into regions calling for different levels of decimation. The primary aim of readying the high poly mesh is to clean and mitigate artifacts. Because the strength setting for each of the smoothing brushes acts relative to the density of polys in the target surface, I'll sometimes begin with the reduced poly brush to make cleaning easier. Under Sculpt, select the reduced poly brush and play with brush size and strength on a section to observe the effect. The idea is to only reduce poly count lightly, where you know it's not going to disturb profiles while making cleaning easier. Get to know the three smoothing brushes, especially Robust Smooth, but also Bubble Smooth and Shrink Smooth. How these and other sculpt brushes are used to clean is for another tut. For now, the cleaning and light decimation may bring the 15 million polys down to, say, 12 million. Which you can monitor as you go down on the bottom right. I'll export this mesh as LO1A12MMM for MeshMixer. Depending on how confident I am this is it for cleaning, I can either play it safe and save this MeshMixer project as a high poly version, allowing me to return to it, or to conserve on storage and backup, I can save the MeshMixer project just for the part number and title it LO1AMM. Either way, saving the MeshMixer project can save you. After importing LO1A12MMM to Reality Capture, I'll simplify to 4 million, rename to LO1A4MRC, and export once again for a second round trip to MeshMixer. I'll now use the reduced brush to more aggressively go after the highly planar sections that, as I suggested before, featured a texture we can offload to normal maps. To speed things along, and at the same time to act most aggressively decimating, I'll select a larger brush size and max strength level for the reduced poly brush, being careful with brush strokes to paint as close as possible to edges and corners without stepping over. I'll sometimes leave wireframes visible to monitor my progress, and other times I can see better without. A pen and tablet is highly recommended for this work, as is the space mouse. It taking a while to get used to planting the brush in a spot and waiting for the processor to catch up and render its effect before proceeding with a continuous brush stroke. The longer the better, as every time you lift the brush, you'll lose some time planting it again. When I'm done, I note the poly count, export the OBJ, and name it LO1A3MMM. Back in Reality Capture, I import the low poly mesh and preserve its name in the selected model window. Selecting LO1A12MMM, I'll open Unwrap. By style, select Fixed Texel Size. Leave Optimal Texel Size as the default. Then proceed with Unwrap, followed by Texture. With LO1A3MMM selected, I'll now set a target try count in Simplify to an amount that best balances quality against a possible hit on performance. Because I'm eager to preserve silhouettes in quite a volume of bric-a-brac all along this top shelf, I'm going with 1 million. Name this new component LO1A1MRC. Under Unwrap, I'll now keep an eye on the large triangle removal value. Having greatly reduced poly count in the highly planar surfaces, we want to avoid losing texture resolution here. So, if I see large blank sections in the checkerboard, I'll keep bumping up large triangle removal until these are gone. We're almost there. Under Texture Reprojection, I select LO1A12MMM for Source Model and LO1A1MRC for Result Model. I enable Color Reprojection and Normal Reprojection and click Reproject. That's it. I hope it's useful. A big thanks to Capturing Reality for bringing awesomeness to photogrammetry.